You know, we are approaching the end of the book of Deuteronomy. And, you know, we have 2 weeks off after tonight. We have our dinner, then we have Thanksgiving with your families, and then we'll resume. We have one more Wednesday in December, and then I think maybe two more Wednesdays, one more in November, two in December. I believe we will finish the book of Deuteronomy the next time we meet, which will be the last Wednesday in November. But tonight is amazing. Tonight, we are going to talk about the very last words that Moses recorded upon this earth. Really amazing to me, the very last words. And, you know, even in lieu of or in view of last week, I do believe that God is doing something great. I do believe that the book of Deuteronomy was chosen for us to prepare us for the greatness that lies in front of us. I really do. Amen, Pop? Even with us being in our 30th year, and we believe that we are on the threshold of greatness. And we believe that God is preparing us for this. Last week, I think God mentioned the blessing that he has for all of us and that he's going to use us all for. And I think he caused things to rise up inside of us. He caused a certain greatness inside of us to rise up because he's going to use it. He's going to call upon that gift that you have for the great things that are in front of us. And every time I look into your lives, I see the folks that come into the doors, even on a Wednesday night, I see nothing but greatness. I believe that God called you here and he has prepared us for the greatness that is in front of us. I believe that. And, you know, even as Moses was getting ready to leave this earth, the last words that he spoke upon the earth, I believe these words are really significant to us tonight. As we go out into this new endeavor that God has for us. So look into your notes with me. We're in the 33rd chapter of Deuteronomy, and it's the last one, two, three, four verses. The subtitle tonight is Moses' last words. Last words that were spoken upon this planet, or recorded at least. So maybe Pastor Dad, maybe we can read those words. Go ahead, sir. Amen. Praise God. After these words, we come into chapter 34, which we'll discuss the next time we come, and that will be the death of Moses. That will be when God himself will bury Moses in a place that nobody knows. Maybe we'll get some insight in regard to that when we meet next time. But these are his last words. Now look in your commentary with me, the commentary. These are the last words of Moses. In his last breath, or with his last breath, he magnifies both the God of Israel, and what is so beautiful, he also magnifies the Israel of God. He takes note of what God has taken note. Notice this. He magnifies the Israel of God. Where prior to this, the reason why Scripture says he could not enter into the land was because he did not magnify the Israel of God. Instead, he stood up in front of the congregation with Aaron by his side, and he said, you rebels. And a short time passes by, his last words, Moses doesn't stand up and say, you rebels. He says, you are the Israel of God. You are the blessed of Almighty. There is no one more precious than you upon the face of the earth. How does that happen? How does he call him the rebel and then call him the most blessed of all? I'll tell you what, we do it all day, every day. And it's a beautiful thing. It's not a bad thing. Because you and I can come into a church or a setting, or we can interact with each other's lives, and sometimes we just get caught up in the everyday stuff, the things that bother us about each other, how we annoy each other, and over time, you know, there's irritations among us, and sometimes we see the failures or the inadequacies of each other rather than the powerful thing that God is doing in our lives. I'm encouraged. If you're not encouraged, I'm encouraged. Because all too often we can get together and we hear this chitter chatter and we really don't hear the victory of God. I hear as you hear that the first things out of our lips sometimes still is complaints and criticism and negativism. My goodness, just before our Wednesday service, I can't even get out of my office without hearing it. And then sometimes we get together and we're stuck in the affairs of life, but yet in the midst of it, before I come up to speak, I believe that God says he's calling us to greatness. At the same time, I believe he's calling us to greatness, because I think what dwells hand in hand with us as human beings is the absolute power of God that dwells inside of us. And no matter how much we love each other or annoy each other from time to time, the truth of the matter is God has called us together for great purpose. And I know when I look into your lives, there's absolute greatness. Nothing will take that away. No matter how much you annoy me or I annoy you, nothing will take away from that greatness. Can I get an honest amen from somebody? Amen. That's an honest amen. Amen.
There
you go. There you go, right from the top. Is that the truth? Let that comfort you, because it comforts me. Because sometimes I look around you and I say, greatness? Oh, I'm just so bothered by the day. And we see it here with Moses. Before Israel was going to do the greatest thing ever recorded in history, this nomadic people were going to destroy the greatest nations on earth and become a nation, the birth of a nation. The birth of the nation Israel. Not just a nation. It was the birth of God's nation. The birth of God's nation. And just prior to this, they were complaining wanderers in a wilderness. The leader himself couldn't stop from complaining. But God is in the midst of us. It is still Almighty God that is inside of us and is going to work through us. Isn't that amazing? Is that amazing to you? Because I know both realms are so real. And I'm encouraged, even as we speak together tonight, that God has called us to something really great. I see that the anointing of the elders and the deacons this year, and the different offices that we have, and the different committees that we have, I believe that God is preparing us for greatness. I believe our base of leadership has expanded for the purpose of a larger structure to be built on top of it. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Yeah, so even with this, in his last words, Moses does not say, you rebels, or how you've annoyed me, or he says, you are blessed of God. And not to mention the special blessing that he gave to each tribe. Now look in your commentary, it says that this was the honor of Israel. Now, every nation around them boasted of its God. But none had such a God to boast of as Israel had. You know, every nation boasted of their God. They wouldn't have it otherwise. You know, Pharaoh rejoiced in Ra until Jehovah came. Oh, yeah. And they called upon their gods all the time. He said, Moses, you got gods? We got gods. And there was a battle of the gods until Moses' God swallowed up their God and was like, oh, okay. Our gods were just swallowed up. Do we have any more gods? So, yeah, we got lots of them. We only have one. Israel only has one, the true God. Every nation boasted of their gods. But Israel was marching on the scene, and they had the true God. And everybody in the world knew it. The whole world knew it. And some were fond of them and wanted to befriend them, but most just quaked in fear because they knew they were coming. They knew they were coming, and I believe deep down inside, like God even gave them the forewarning, you're going down, right? Wow. Wow. So this is the God of Israel. Let's see, what does it say? I do want to get through our notes tonight. But number two, it says two things he takes notice of as proof of his incontestable preeminence of the God of Jeshurun. The God of Jeshurun means, Jeshurun is a name of someone who is beloved. And Israel is Jeshurun. God dearly loves Israel, so he calls him Jeshurun, the God of Jeshurun, above all of the gods. And then it describes how he operates. It says in number one that God, he is riding upon the heaven, and the clouds is a figure used to show, you know, his unlimited omnipotence. He is all-powerful, with which God rules the world out of heaven and is the helper of his people. God rules this world, but he rules it from heaven. And just because he's in heaven, make no mistake, he does rule the world. Let it be comforting to us, even in the times that we are living in, with all of the elections, know this. I don't care who is the leader and who is this and that. God is the one who rides upon the clouds, he sits in the heavens, and he does rule the world. He rules it from an invisible place. He puts up who he wants to put up, and he takes down who he wants to take down. It's just that simple, everybody. And he will use anybody at any time. Man, he is absolutely sovereign, omnipotent. And the greater revelation we have on this, the greater peace we'll have, the less foolish conversation we'll have. We'll realize that we belong to such a greater kingdom. Oh, my. Oh, my. It's like all the other gods. We worship the true and living God. Why are we so entangled with these other gods? But he rules the earth from heaven. Number two, his boundless eternity. He is the eternal God. Okay. Talks about his arms being everlasting. See, the gods of the heathen were but lately invented, you know. They had a new god, like, I don't know how often they had a new god. I mean, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of gods, you know. So some of their gods were like brand new. Like the gods got together, they had a child, poof, we got another god. Whatever, yeah. And, you know, it's kind of what goes on today. I mean, you know, whatever greatness shows up, you know, sometimes we bow and worship to things, you know. But anyway, they had a new god all the time. But Israel's God was the God from beginning. He is from beginning to end. It says that their gods would shortly perish, for sure. But the God of Jeshurun is eternal. And he was before all worlds and will be when times and days shall be no more. He is the one from everlasting to everlasting. Believe it or not, other gods do rise and fall, but our God is eternal. Wow. Everybody, we are the people of God. We have the one true God. God is opening our eyes and our hearts to understand this, that we realize, and not only do we realize, we take note of, we are chosen, we are special. Grab hold of it, thank God for it. The whole world will be blessed by it. We are not of this world. We are not of this world. Stop acting like it, stop talking like it, stop thinking like it. You are far above it all, because you're with your God in heaven. And from the heavens is where we rule the earth. It's where we bring peace and righteousness and truth and mercy. We have no idea who we are. And God is explaining to us before we enter into this. He's saying, you are my people. He says, I chose you. I chose you. I chose you. I chose you to show forth my greatness. And I put inside of you the power of heaven. And he released it to us last week. I know he released it to us last week. The power of heaven resides inside of you. And he opens up our eyes even for one another, so we don't get discouraged about the petty nonsense that goes on in our lives all day long, that we can still see the greatness of God inside this church, inside this body, inside our family, inside our lives. Amen. Amen. Amen, everybody. So somebody read that verse. It's a good verse. 2 Samuel 7:23. Somebody read that one.
And who is like your people Israel, the one nation on earth that God went out to redeem as a people for himself, and to make it
Amen to that. And Samuel is speaking this, which is, you know, it's way after the time of Moses and the time of Joshua. He repeats this. We are the one nation redeemed by God. Why are you redeemed? Why are you sitting in church on a Wednesday? Why do you go to church at all? Why? Because you're the ones that God chose. He redeemed you. He chose you. He chose you, it says. Out of all the peoples of the earth, he chose you. He chose to reveal himself to you so that you can show the world who God is. Little by little. But the thing about you as the people of God is this. Let me tell you something. Make no mistake and do not forget it. Listen, the whole world does not know God. They don't know God. You know God. Why? Because you studied? No. He revealed himself to you. He made himself known to you for purpose. Who else is there greater to represent on the earth than God? You know God. You can walk into any situation, any circumstance, and you can declare the God of the heavens and the earth, his purpose, his plan, his presence, his peace, his love, is everything. You are the ones on the earth that know God. You represent God. You bring God. You are the people of God. More and more we're realizing this and we're saying, no, we're not like the world. We are chosen to greatness. Chosen to greatness. I love the fact that God chose us, don't you? I mean, I really enjoy that God chose me to know him. Of all the things there is to know in life, I would rather know God than anything else. Of course. I'd rather know God than to be a great mathematician or a great scientist. I'd rather know God than to create something or to fly man to the moon or to Mars. I'd rather know God than to be rich and famous. But wouldn't you? I believe your desire is for what God has called you to. You want what God has given you. You have the greatest thing of all. If God could come and stand in front of you and say, I'll give you anything you want, what do you want? Your answer would be, Lord, I just want to know you. If I could have you. And God says, how dare you ask? But he'll say yes. How dare you ask? But it's my pleasure to give you myself. He has everything all around him. He says, what do you want? And you push it all aside. Can I have you? Can I have you? And that is your relationship with God. You have God. And God wants to use that because he's going to make his name known on the earth through a people. God will be known through you. And I think we see that in the next passage. Why don't you turn your page with me? Now, I want you to know this. I want you to know, I believe God wants to reveal something to us tonight. I think God, this is beautiful, everybody. God wants to make himself known to us again in a special way so that we can in turn be the representatives of God upon the earth. He will make himself known to you. You will know God like no one else. You will be blessed first, but then you'll give it away, everybody. Now, God speaks our language. I think we know this. God speaks our language. Because if God spoke in divine language, nobody would understand him. Nobody would understand. You ever hear somebody talk about physics or whatever is above your head, you know, and you know, they could be talking real intelligent things, but at the end of the conversation, I have no idea what you're talking about. Your doctor could be talking about drugs and how it affects your body or whatever, you know. I hear nutritionists talk about certain things, and at the end, I don't even know, I don't even care. Just tell me, what does this do for me? Will it give me energy? I'm just looking for energy. We're crying out loud. I don't even care. And I do go to the nutrition store often, and he's on and on and on about beta receptors. I don't care. It doesn't work. If God spoke to us in divine language, nobody would understand him. Paul said when he talked to heaven, he said, I saw things that you cannot utter because you can't speak divine language. And some of the theologians have thought of an example, and they would ask, I guess, they would ask you to think to yourself. Think to yourself, if you would. And if you had to explain, maybe you've heard this scenario before, but if you had to explain to somebody in the Stone Age, what was the electric light bulb and the electric conduit, the electricity that flows through the wire to this light bulb in the house, how could you explain the electric light bulb and electricity to somebody who lived in the Stone Age? And if you think about this, and as I thought about this, quite honestly, all by myself, when that was presented to me, I thought about it, and I have to use the elements of their world. I thought about the vines. Like a vine, I would use as an analogy as an electrical wire. And I would say that the light bulb is like having a little sun in your house. That's what the electric light bulb is. I would have to speak to them in their language with the surroundings that they live in, right? In order for them to understand. And that's what God does with us. He speaks to us the same way. So there in your notes, God uses language of the earth to explain heavenly things to us, to explain eternal things. He uses earthly language. And then we get confused because we think he's earthly, but he's not. It's not like you have a little sun in your house. He's just trying to explain to you, you know? And I love those analogies because in the Bible, it talks about the sun often, and we get so confused, and we say, oh, it's a blood moon today, and it has nothing to do with the moon. It has nothing to do with the sun. God was just trying to speak to us in terms that we can understand. And now we're looking to the moon, we're looking to the sun, we're looking to the stars, we're looking to the waves, we're looking to meteors. I'm not talking about that, God says. I was just trying to speak to you in terms that you understand. So even here in the final blessing of Israel, God describes himself. I want us to see that God describes himself to us in terms of the human body. And he uses four human symbols that I want to talk about. He uses four human symbols. He uses hands. He describes himself by the use of human hands, by the use of human feet, shoulders, and arms. We're going to look at those four real quickly. And always know this, God is an eternal spirit. God does not have hands. God does not have feet. God does not have shoulders, and God does not have arms. He is eternal spirit. He is all in all. He fills all of the universe. He fills every living thing and everything that we would even consider non-living. He is the existence of all matter. He does not have hands and feet, everybody. Amen? But you know, he also describes himself to us even through human emotions, because in the Bible, lots of times it says that God rejoices, or it says that he grieves, or it says that he has zeal, or things like that, right? He tries to describe himself to us in terms that we understand, but he's far beyond these terms. I like the fact that he also represents himself to us. He says he describes himself as a husband. He describes himself as a father, as a shepherd. But in the same breath, he describes himself as a rock, as a shield, as a refuge, as a cloud. Interesting. He describes himself as the sun, the moon, and the stars. You see, all of creation reflects God's glory. There is not one atom in all of the universe that does not show forth the glory of God. That's who God is. And in order for him, in his divinity, eternity, everything, to begin to explain himself to us, he uses human terms. And I think all too often we get caught up in the human terms. And I say, let us not get caught up in these human terms, in these things that God uses to explain himself, because he is far above them and beyond them all. We can't explain our lives. We can't truly explain end times, if you will, the silliness of end times, in regard to human terms. He was just using that metaphor. I feel like I'm a caveman in the Stone Age. Like God said, it's like a little sun in your house. And all of a sudden, I'm looking for a blood moon. I'm looking for a sun that's going to burn hot. I'm looking for meteors coming out of the sky. And God says, you are, what do you call guys of the Stone Age? What do you call them? Don't have a sun. what are they called? Neanderthals, what we are? Cavemen, yeah. Yeah, it's like, you Neanderthal, you caveman. And that's how we act when we think that God is really that way. Interesting? I think so. I think God is beyond all of that. So let's look at them. Okay. In verse 3 of Deuteronomy 33, it says that he has hands. Does somebody want to read there in your notes that partial verse 3 there? Okay, thank you. Now, this is one of the blessings that Moses gives to the children of Israel and what he uses to describe God. And he tells the children of Israel the final blessing as they go into this land and they become a nation. He gives them the blessing and he says, you are in the hands of God. God doesn't have hands, but he says, you are in the hands of God. What does that mean? And here it means, and we've seen it declared and described and defined, that God is our provider, everybody. You know, it's from the hand of God that he provides us. God is our absolute provider. Even this is so beautiful. I believe God was even speaking to us this throughout this series, that God says he's our provider. As they go into the land and they find this land that flows with milk and honey and it's watered from the rain of heaven. And even though they go to work the fields, they might get tempted to think that they produce the harvest because they work the fields. And they believed it so much that they wouldn't let the land rest, right? They just would not let the land rest because they didn't believe that God could provide for them if they didn't work. So they worked. They didn't believe that God could provide for them if they didn't work. So they worked. I had to say it twice. God says, you're going to work. You are going to work, but it's not for provision. I am your provider. God says, if your fields fail you, I provide. You are not the provider. I am not the provider. Our jobs are not where our provision comes from. Our provision comes from God. And with that, it should give us a sense of security. And even with that security, doesn't Scripture say that we are in the hands of God, that no one can snatch us out of the hands of God? Even in regard to our salvation, no one can snatch us out of the hands of God. That talks about eternal security. Nothing can take you from God. Nothing can take you from God. Because you are not holding on to God, everybody. Your strength and your hand is not holding on to God. His strength and his hand is holding on to you. This is the blessing from Moses to Israel. He's in your hands. That means forever and ever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen. I don't care what you do, how bad you mess up, what nations you go into bondage. He says, you are forever in my hands. That's the blessing. It's eternal security. It's everlasting provision. Beautiful, huh? Even talks about his strength there. What's the second one? Talks about his feet. Somebody read 3 and 4 there on your notes.
At your feet they all bow down, and from you receive instruction. And the law that Moses gave us, the possession of the assembly of Jacob.
Okay. So it does talk about us sitting at the feet of God and receiving the law of Moses, or instruction, right? Guidance, wisdom, counsel. So the feet does speak of God being our teacher. And I would think, even as Moses, his last words on earth, you got to figure. Now, Joshua was a great warrior, man. Okay, they're confident. They're going to go do some battle. They're confident. We got Joshua, no problem. But in regard to the old man, they might say, well, who's going to teach us? Who's going to guide us? Who will give us counsel, though? Who can we trust? Where do we get our answers from? We used to go to Moses. And the blessing here is that anytime you stop and you sit at the feet of God, anytime you pause in life, if you stop, you're a rat race. Remember Mary? She chose the one thing that was profitable. If you pause and you sit at the feet of God, you receive your guidance and your counsel and your instruction. You receive it in your quietness. Who will teach us? Scripture says, he, the Holy Spirit, will teach you about all things. You are the people of God. You have something that no one else has, and you don't know it. Because you've had it for a long time and it's just second nature to you, you have no idea who you are. Not everybody has what you have. Not everybody has what you have. You have the ability to talk to God and say, God, I need an answer. I need direction. I need guidance. And he speaks to you. And I can remember all through my life in situations that were beyond me. How about you? I would ask God. You know, after I worried and thought about it, and like you had an epiphany, oh, I'll ask God. And I can remember incident after incident after incident, from the greatest of matters to the simplest of matters. And I would say, God, I don't know what to do here. And usually he'll speak to you sometimes immediately as you ask. Or as you sit in silence after all of your worrying. And God is so beautiful. God has never failed me. It even happened today. I was remembering the days of old, how I would ask God for guidance, and he was so quick. And I say, well, why am I fretting over these decisions? I'm just going to ask God. And his answers are so beautiful. God ever give you an answer that's just beautiful? It's like, that is brilliant, God. I never could have thought of that in all of my wildest dreams. That is brilliant. It covers all the bases. We have this. We have this in life. Not everybody has this. It's at our disposal. It's so easy. I'm going to use it again. I'm getting ready to use it. Like, I mean, I'm busy talking to you right now, but when I'm done talking to you, I'm going to talk to him. And I said, Lord, what do I do here? It is about some of you too, by the way. What do I do here? What do I do here? What do I do here? And he's the brilliant one. That's so beautiful. Okay. He describes himself as one who has shoulders. So go ahead and read that short piece there, verse 12. Somebody read that.
And he shall dwell between his shoulders.
Thank you. This is the blessing that Moses gave to us, to the children of Israel, the chosen ones. It says that we have the blessing of being able to dwell between his shoulders. Now, yes, the shoulders can speak of strength, and I don't think I'm going to stay there. Yes, it speaks of strength. Yes, we have the strength of God in our lives, no doubt about it. But I think there's something greater than that where the strength might even flow from. I mean, what's the one organ that sits right between the shoulders? It's your heart, man. And God enables us to dwell between his shoulders, and I believe it's right here on his heart. Now, I'm not looking for greatness or strength. I'm looking for his heart. And so many times you can bow before God and you can have a list of things to pray, but then all of a sudden you can say, Lord, I just need to know you. I just need to know your heart. What is your heart? And I know that John the disciple, he was mentioned as the one who laid his head on the breast or the chest or the bosom of Christ. Amen. He knew the heart of God. And we explained last week when so many people were in turmoil over so many things, they just finally asked John. They said, John, ask Jesus. Ask Jesus. And it seemed like John, if you remember, he had the rest in the midst of troubled times because he laid his head between the shoulders of Christ. And I believe that we have this blessing to lay our head between the shoulders of Christ, that in the midst of troubled times, everybody, the world might be going through a troubled times. Listen, we're never troubled. We're never troubled over any election, over any event, over any uprising. It doesn't trouble us. We are the ones who are chosen by God, and one of our blessings is this. We are not troubled in times. We have nothing but rest or peace in times of trouble. And if anyone would ask, we would have an answer for those to ask. As God says, be ready to answer those who ask you, what is your hope? What is your hope? Be ready to have an answer, God says. Don't shout it in their face. Wait until they ask. You know, sometimes it says, wait until they ask. You ever wonder, how do you introduce God to folks? God says, wait until they ask. And if they ain't asking you, you better investigate why they ain't asking you. Because maybe you're acting just like them. Maybe you look and just like them. But if you're not acting just like them, they're going to say, well, what's your hope? What's different about you? Why don't you do what we do? Well, didn't they say they think it's strange that you don't run after the things that they run after? We're doing this. Why aren't you doing this? What do you have? What is your peace? What is your quietness? What is your wisdom? Where is your strength? And we say, well, since we are the ones who have been blessed to dwell between his shoulders, not only do we know the heart of God, but we can reveal the heart of God. There's nothing greater. There's nothing greater. The final one, everybody, is arms. And I think that's a beautiful one because it talks about God being our Savior. You know, he is our Savior. Moses told Israel, God will be your Savior. Somebody read that short part of verse 27 there. Amen. God is our refuge, and underneath are his everlasting arms. I like that it says underneath are his arms. Underneath symbolizes, of course, he reaches down from heaven to earth and this realm. But it also says to you and to me, as we are blessed by God through Moses, or we're just blessed by God through Christ, it says no matter how low you go, his arms are underneath you. No matter how low you go. What kind of a blessing is that? You can't pay for that kind of a blessing. You can't pay for that. No matter how low you go, his arms are underneath you. Meaning that he you are secure. First of all, before you get out of that low place, in that low place, you're secure. You're safe. I know you're in hell, and I know hell's all around you. But when you're in your hell, you're in his arms.